Yeah. Okay, perfect. So I think we can start. But my first question to you guys is, how are you after the lunch? Yay! Yay. Yay. How is the energy level? Not that. Thanks. Thank you so much. So I would like to invite you for a very lightweight talk about psychology. And I think it's a great talk to kick out the second part of the day. And as I said, it's very lightweight, so you can ask the questions in the meantime. And I would also really appreciate your input. So my name is Kasia, and I'm a psychologist, and I work in an IT company. So before we actually move on, I would like to tell you a short story how I actually ended up working in IT company being a psychologist. So it happened that psychologists are needed in HR and recruitment in IT companies. So I started there. And during my first day, a job just before I started, I had this, oh, is it better? Okay, thanks. So before my first time and job, I thought that, okay, I will be working with a bunch of programmers. So, yeah. The people that like deliberately chosen to spend their lives in front of computers, not with like other people. The people that are actually writing the lines of code, I don't understand, creating something, I have no idea. So that were my assumptions. And after my first day at job, I actually understood that people with whom I'm about to start my work are actually people. And trust me, yes, trust me, that was something that struck me. So I started in recruitment, but not soon after, I realized that there's this huge bench of software development that is as much as it is about the technology, it is about people. So I slowly moved there, and I've discovered Agile. And when I started to get to know Agile, I saw the Agile Manifesto, because this is the point where like everyone starts. So I read the first value that was stated there, and that said that individual and interactions are more important than processes and tools. So for me, it was like, oh my goodness, that's psychology. So this is exactly what we do as a psychologist. We are mostly on people and individuals, and how the people work together, how they can create something good together. So, as you can imagine, I fell in love instantly, and I thought that, okay, this is a spot for me. But, for example, in Poland, it's not that common to have people working in agile teams who are not coming from IT or management background. So let me just follow up on Karolina's experiment, and could you guys raise the hand, whoever is not from IT or management background? Okay, who are you? Perfect, perfect. And who are you? Linguist. You? Perfect. Who else? You. Oh my goodness, I have my people in this room. Oh, you guys can check and see and, well, check me if I'm telling the right stuff, and if not, like, you can interfere. So you see, it's not that common, but it happened. So this is a good sign. So today I will guide you through the journey of a team that I would like you to get to know better. So this is our team for today. The girl with the ponytail is a scrum master. Her name is Marysia, and I've chosen some Polish names just to show you a bit of Polish culture. So Marysia is a scrum master, and that's not her first project that she's working on. She was leading some team, and she's experienced. So the guy with the beard there, this one, his name is Adrian. He's the guy that is software developer, and he's the one that you can probably notice when he comes to the work. So Adrian is the one who will shout from the door like, oh, how was today? And this is the guy that you just cannot miss. It's a very important team member, but it's very loud, and you have to just get to know him to work with him good. So the girl in the middle is Agnieszka. So Agnieszka is actually a very quiet person. She's very analytical. She's also a software developer. She likes to think about things, so she's very analytical. And there's no decision that she can make on the spot. And she just tries to spend as much time as she can working alone. How about now? Yeah, okay, perfect. So we have got Agnieszka in the middle. The guy who's holding a cup of coffee, his name is Martin. Martin is also a kind of person that you would like to have in your team because he's caring about others.
Why doesn't he have bags?
He has. Like, it's a trendy color this season. So probably you would like to have Martin in your team because he's very caring with pants on. So the last guy there in the blue shirt with pants also, his name is Adam. He's very young, he's very bright, and he will be kind of type that you would probably call a superstar. He's solving all of the problems. He also likes to work together, but he's really good in teamwork. But he's also like kind of cocky when it comes to being a developer, so he's very confident. But he's smart, and everyone wants to have him in his team. So this is our team for today, and we will follow them through their adventures. So there will be no talk in psychology without this magic world, personality. So personality, as you probably know, is a set of traits and a set of patterns that describes our behavior and our thinking styles, and personality is unique for every single person. So imagine Marysia, our Scrum Master, who just got to know her team, and she's observing them a lot, and she wants to gather as much knowledge on them as she can. So she's paying a lot of attention on how actually they work together, whether they prefer to work alone or in a team, how they actually behave in real life environment. And Marysia heard this magical word personalities, and she started to read more about different theories. And as you probably know, she got online, and there are a lot of researches and a lot of researches on that. So she's reading a lot, and all she can find are very complex theories, or theories that are definitely not applicable for her job. So she probably stumbled upon MBTI. Who of you have heard about it? 16 personality style? Yes. So this is the test that tells the difference on between people and categorize them into 16 personalities. 16. That's a lot. That is not something like you can work on daily basis. And she stumbles upon the theory of Big Five. So this is very theoretical. It's a base of personalities when it comes to psychology. So these theories were not for her. She wanted something that will be applicable for the team and something that she can work on daily basis, and also something that will be easily understood for the guys there in her team. So she found a theory, and its name is DISC, and it has got very great attachment to it, the birds. So when Marysia started to get to know the theory and with the birds, she thinks that it's probably a little bit childish to actually categorize people into being different birds. But then it works really well. So we have got four main styles. We have got dominant, interactive, supportive, and conscientious, which corresponds with different birds. So Marysia started to pay a lot of attention when it comes to her team members, and she found out this, that every single team member of hers is a different bird in the personality styles. So we have got Adam, this young developer, who is an eagle, definitely. So eagle is a person who can make decisions on the spot, is very deliberate on his needs, and sometimes can dominate the discussion. So this is the person that, for example, during the meeting, will be the one asking questions and will be the one always having something to say. And we also have got Parrot here. So we have got Adrian. And Parrot is a person that is really into people, but in a really like, maybe not offensive, but very, very strict way. So Adrian, as I told the story about entering the office and saying hi to everyone, is a person who will be loud, who will be colorful, always attracting people and feeling really good in the crowd. So probably this is the person that will unite the team, but in a like a very loudly style. And we also have got a Dove, Martin, without pens, sorry. So Martin is a caring person, and he's the person that will unite the team, but paying a lot of attention to how individuals feel. So Martin is also a very, very important team member. Martin, as a Dove, may be quiet, but will also approach you when you're feeling bad or you are not in a good mood or there's something wrong. So Parrot and the Dove are two personalities that are very people-oriented, but Adrian probably cannot see that something is going wrong. On the other hand, Martin will see it. And also we have got Agnieszka, the analytical thinker, and all stands for that. All stands for the analytical thinkers, people who like to work alone, and people who probably during the meeting will not make a single decision, but 2 hours after they will come to you with a plan and how they want to implement something. So it's really good to find a balance in your team, because when you have 4 people and they're all eagles, that might be pretty complicated. They might not kill each other, but it may be really hard to manage them properly. And also if you have got a lot of owls, you can have a lot of great thinkful solutions, but maybe without this power to implement it. So it's really good to know your team, and DISC is a great tool to do that. So the first statement that I would like to present to you today is people have got very unique personalities. Moving forward, people have got different experience. And you can imagine the situation when we have got Martin, our developer, and he's working differently with Adrian, and he's working differently with Agnieszka. The fact is that he was working with Adrian before, and he was like the junior people in the pair, junior person in the pair. So he may not be the kind of person that was willing to express himself in this configuration. However, this is the first time that he's working with Agnieszka, so he's really fond of expressing his opinions, proposing something new. So Marysia, our Scrum Master, found out about it. So she observed that he's acting differently when working with those two people. And what she did was she confronted them with the situation, and they come up with something. They decided that if you're starting a new project, you have to start fresh. You have to de-roll every single person you have on your project, because they might be working together in different configuration before, and that might influence how they are working together in this certain project. And also, it's really important to have new working agreements when it comes to this particular team. And whenever you're starting a new project and you're becoming a Scrum Master, for example, on this project, it's really good to emphasize that, guys, this is the new start, this is the new project. This is, you may be working with the same people, but it's different this time. So the first statement is people like to be owners. So have you heard about IKEA effect? No? Okay. Yes. Okay, perfect. So basically, to all of you who haven't heard about it, is that when you are buying a furniture in IKEA, you get it in a box with this tiny screwdriver, and you have to assemble the furniture yourself. And it is proven that when you are making something yourself, it belongs to you, because you invested something. You've invested your time, you've invested your energy, and you've invested the effort of building that. So that's why you're protecting it, and that's why you are kind of more attached to it. So we have Adam in our team. Adam, who's an eagle, and he's saying that everything he's creating is his, and he's very attached. So there are some challenges when it comes to other team members when giving Adam's feedback on his code, because he's really protecting that, and he believes that what he creates have got a very, very high quality. So sometimes it's really hard to give feedback to Adam. And what Marysia did, Marysia, as a Scrum Master, confronted Adam with this, and she created a very safe space to give feedback to him, so that other team members are not afraid anymore of approaching Adam and saying, I mean, come on, you've done it really wrong, and you have to fix it. And I can help you with fixing that, but still you have to fix it. And Adam, on the other hand, is more peaceful when it comes to receiving this feedback. So he's not an owner anymore, but he's something who takes part in all of the creation process. So next one is, people like to be praised. And you probably have heard a lot about feedback, and there's no chance for me to repeat everything. But there is this very special kind of feedback, which is positive feedback and positive reinforcement, that was tested in psychology for years. And Skinner tried to make habits when it comes to animals' behaviors based either on punishment or a praise. And it turned out that praise works really good. And we as people are animals, sorry to say that. And it works like that on us. So we like to be praised, but it has to be a special praised. So Marysia, during the retrospective the team had, have got this separate table with appreciation. But that happened once in a while. It was really important for the team members to hear something good about themselves, but it was not on very regular, something they skip it, and it just happened once in a week or 3 weeks. So Marysia found this really cool tool that I would love to present to you, which is called the LeoBot. Who of you uses Slack? So I really recommend you guys to take a look on that. This is a bot that you can connect to Slack that is created by a company called Office Vibe. And you should also see this company, as they are having a lot of great resources to read. So LeoBot gathers feedback about the company, but it has got the small features of gathering praise to different people. So you can set it up to set the reminders to your team members to actually praise something. And it takes you about 30 seconds to fill it in. So it asks you questions, for example, one thing I think Mateusz does well is, and you can type it, you have got 140 characters to fill it in. So it is taking you very little time. It's so great to read it when you are starting your work day and you are opening Slack and you have got this really cool sentence about yourself. And what Marysia noticed as a Scrum Master is that people in her team are not afraid of giving praise anymore. So it becomes something natural. It formed this great habit of actually approaching a person and saying, I think you do this right. Because it happens that sometimes in our jobs we are hearing things that we actually have to improve, not the things that we've done good. And people like to be praised. People have their life, as the next sentence. Outside, yeah. I will get to that. So Marysia, as a Scrum Master, always has to remember that she has an access just to one system where people are living. So she has got the access just for the system of work. And her information about the certain persons, people are limited to only one system. But we as people live in very, very different systems. We have got our work, our family, our friends, our extracurricular activities, anything that we are fond of. And Marysia, as a Scrum Master, has to remember that sometimes the problems in the other sphere are affecting the work. And it's really good to know the source, but sometimes it's really good to find the place where to stop digging, because probably there is something more to that. And we, as people working with teams, also have to remember about it, that people have got different lives, different experiences, And it's really important to have it in our mind when we are trying to solve the problem and we are pretty sure that the reason is somewhere there in our work. It may not be, it may be. So we have to be very delicate on that. And people have their expectations. And of course, when you're starting a project, you have got this one big goal. But sometimes it happens that there are other goals in other people's minds. And they may not be aligned. And when we are starting new projects, it's really great to get it on the table. So we are stating the expectation for us as a team, for us as people who are working on the project, delivering something, and for every single person. Because it might happen that these people have got very different goals. And it's good to get to know them at the beginning and address them, address their needs, and but to wait until something goes wrong. So just remember about it. And wrapping up, we have got six sentences that describe people. We have got personality, we have got experience, ownership, praise, life, and expectations. And as you probably see, it's people after all. So when working with people, you gotta remember that you are actually working with human beings who are alive, and you have got just an access to a part of them, and they're very, very unique. And this is actually where we can learn from psychology as a science. There are a lot of things that were discovered before, and sometimes there's no chance to reinvent the wheel again. And sometimes it's never even not worth it. There are a lot of great resources, and I can even recommend you some books. I haven't prepared it for that presentation, but you can also approach me and I will give you some really good titles to read. But if there would be just one thing that I want you to leave this talk with, is that you have to remember that there is much more than meets the eye. So when it comes to working in a team, you have to remember that there are many, many things that lies below the waterline. And sometimes we just see the top of the iceberg. And we have to remember that icebergs have got a lot under the water. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer, if I can.
Can you provide some hints on conflict resolution within your hypothetical team?
Oh, great question. I think it depends on the conflict and what is the source of the conflict and what people actually you have. But there is a great book, Nonviolent Communication, by Rosenberg. Have you read this book? So I think it helps. Everything that is stated there helps. But when it comes to the conflict itself, I would say you have to approach them very individually. It's not answering your question.
Okay, maybe I can ask more specifically. What if an owl and an eagle are discussing over the code quality and they cannot agree? Could you provide us some example how to resolve this conflict?
I would say that a proper facilitation there is needed. So probably those two people, I don't know if you can agree with me, cannot make the consensus together, but if there would be this third person coming, having a different perspective as a facilitator, they could change their mind and they can reach something that is in the middle that would satisfy both the needs of an eagle, so the person that is really sure that he's doing the right job, and an owl, a person who wants to have things well thought through. So I would say be there for the conflict.
But then it kind of puts a limitation all the conversations have to have a facilitator, a third person coming in, really limit the bandwidth of all the communication happening.
Mm-hmm. Or maybe just the most important ones, not every communication.
You knew up front which are important ones, you would be lucky, right?
Yeah, that's true.
You want everybody to be able to talk to each other efficiently all the time and having meaningful communication even without facilitator, ideally.
Yes. But I think you can learn those skills. So for example, when the first conflict in the team appears, be there, try to be a facilitator there and debrief it with the entire team and also learn from it. And I think there's a lot when it comes to the knowledge in the teams that comes from the situations, from having a debriefing with the entire team and stating that it's also something natural to have a conflict in the team. But the most important thing is to find a proper way to solve it.
Can we stage an experiment here with this kind of conflict? I think it's very easy to bring up any topic. Persons, you can show how to resolve that. That would be very interesting.
Great. So I think we need... Yeah, we have got 15 minutes. So how about we get 3 volunteers? So the 2 people arguing. So who'd like to be the second person? Oh, perfect. And Susu. And maybe you'd like to be the facilitator.
You asked for it.
Guys, do you need a mic or you can shout at each other?
Mark, of course. So, do we need a topic?
Dynamic languages.
I just remember that first talker asked how many are developers. We need something that non-developers also would understand.
Java versus Ruby.
can we do Scrum versus Kanban?
What's your favorite programming language?
It's again, it's for developers. Let's. Yeah. Can we do Scrum versus Kanban?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What's your favorite?
Kanban.
I'll go with Scrum. Scrum forever.
Just one question for you. Can you hear everything?
No. Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
I'll scream for you! So, I think Scrum is much better than Kanban because for psychological reasons. It has a start and an end, so it's not an endless flow of work coming at you. That's too depressing. So, never use Scrum, Kanban Scrum for everything.
Yeah, but you cannot use Scrum for maintenance project where response...
Oh, you can use Scrum for maintenance.
No, you cannot.
You can have a rotating superposition, solve everything all the time.
You can use it, but it will be just as bad as it was without Scrum.
It's not because
okay, guys, thank you. Now let's do the following way. Can you please tell me for Scrum, what are your feelings towards Scrum?
I love it. It's the best thing ever.
What do you like feel when you do Scrum daily stand-ups? Please describe it to us.
Yeah. I didn't have any pants, you will see. Yeah.
Okay. What are your feelings for Kanban? What do you feel when you use Kanban?
The best you can find. It's agile, more agile than Scrum.
No, it's not.
It has less prescribed rules. So it gives us the freedom to create your own process.
It's okay.
Yeah. I think it's a good idea that you each talk separately. Otherwise, none of us can understand anything. So, as a facilitator, I will take the role of showing who is talking right now, and the other person tries to really listen and understand the other person is saying. Yes, Dmitry, what do you feel when you really indulge into Kanban?
Yes, I feel that Kanban gives us more control over the flow we are working through. So, and we also can control little more tiny things during our work. Besides that, comparing with Scrum, it gives us just a bunch of something and we should deliver a bunch of something by the end of
which actually
sprint.
Means more control, right?
No. It doesn't tell you what to do next. No. It just gives you a bunch of work and you can't control how you do it, right?
Okay, thank you.
More control.
Yeah. So what I understood, Dmitry has, for Dmitry feels that he is in control when he is using Kanban, right?
Yes.
Yes.
But that is imaginary and control.
Stop, please stop. What do you feel? I understood that you are excited about Scrum. You feel excited every day. Yes. Yes? Okay. Then let's talk about your needs, actually. What do you need in Scrum when you are applying Scrum? What are your actually needs?
We need results, and we need to feel good about ourselves. And Scrum gives us that. So it's best.
Okay. Yeah. You personally, what do you personally need?
I feel good about it, and we get results. And I get results. It's good.
What do you mean by results?
We build more bionicles.
So more stuff, yes, is results. Okay.
No, I got the question.
Thank you. Your answer is received. You get more. You need more stuff. Therefore, you use Scrum. Yes. More results.
Okay. I got one question to my opponent first. What kind of medicine you are on?
Okay. This sounds like a judgment. Implied under the line.
Okay.
Yeah, this sounded like a judgment, and it's a risky path to take. As soon as we start to judge something, we go and subconsciously want to kill each other. We are all people, civilized. So, if we continue about your needs, so. Dmitry, what are your needs
for Kanban?
For yourself, and when you use Kanban, you think about that you are addressing it actually.
Then. I need a Kanban for greater visibility of what's going on within a team. I want the possibility to measure each task, how it goes through the whole cycle. So I want to measure lead cycle. All the work being done, and I want to show everyone where our bottlenecks are using manipulation with work in progress limitations and defining stages on our Kanban board accordingly to our real working process, not like having three columns to do in progress and done.
Okay, so now
many Scrum boards.
Okay, thank you. Now try to.
How many columns does a Kanban board have?
Seven.
And does all the every task you have, does it have to really always go through all the seven stages?
No.
And never come back. So is it really true that it gives you a real visibility, or it's just an illusion of visibility?
Can you provide some criteria how to distinguish that?
Okay, here we are observing two software developers in their natural habitat, which is addressing their primary need, which I will guess the primary need at the moment is just to get energized and fight at this moment.
Yeah, this is actually
this is very obvious.
A perfect moment to cut it.
Yeah.
So thank you very much. And so it seems it's not that easy to solve this problem and this fight. And you could have observed something that was kind of a fake environment, but there were a lot of great things that happened, and I just want to emphasize it. So really good work facilitating, really great questions about the emotions, the feelings that are standing behind, and the needs. So whenever there's a conflict, it's really great to address it. And what you did that is also really good to emphasize is that you've played back what Dmitry said. So sometimes it's really good for you as a facilitator to repeat what was said, just as a third person in the conflict. So say, from what I understood, you mean blah, blah, blah. And it means that... sorry, I forgot. So it's really good to gather this other perspective. Any other comments that you guys observed? That's true. So thank you very much. And really, again, a round of applause for you. A lot of emotions in that.